where we were on January 29th when we were at a stalemate was we were discussing 7 weeks, 28 days. Colonial wanted $300,000 from the horsemen to help with various overhead expenses. We offered a package of $150,000. So that was the difference. At that time, we couldn't resolve it. The contract expired, and by law, not our doing, by law, the OTBs had to shut down. Now, that caused customer dissatisfaction, which obviously we certainly wanted to do, right? It's so did the racetrack. The Secretary of Commerce got involved. Secretary Maurice Jones, been on the job for less than 2 weeks, and here he is. He convened a meeting on Valentine's Day, February 14th. And I'm trying to think, everybody, I'm not sure whether Jim was on the conference or not. But David, Stephanie, and myself, and Jim, and Ian, and Bernie, and Sarge. The upshot of that meeting, we went through the whole history, and the upshot was we were talking about 7 weeks, 28 days, and Ian Stewart said he could only do seven weeks, 28 days if it was revenue neutral. And offered to make available financial records. That's the way we left it with the secretary. He said, fine, within the next 30 days, I will see what I can do to have you folks consider the feasibility of seven weeks, 28 days. Subsequent to that February 14th meeting, the secretary followed up with separate meetings. First with Colonial, and then with David, Stephanie, and myself. Now, I don't know what happened at the Colonial meeting, but I can tell you that when we left the meeting on February 24th, I described for the secretary where we stood. I think you were present for me at that. And the secretary said, well, it was 7 weeks, 28 days, and I said that we were apart, 150 versus 300,000. He says, fine, I understand. Let me make some phone calls, I'll get back to you. Well, what I assume the secretary then did was to arrange the formal mediation that we had 2 weeks later with Judge Donald. We wrote a separate memorandum on our view of mediation and settlement prospects to Judge Donald. And Colonial did the same thing. We were private. We told the judge where we stood and that we were prepared to go further, that we had put together a package that we calculated would be $280,000, about $20,000 is what Colonial was saying. To my way of thinking, that seemed to be a deal. The mediator, as far as I know, never got around to being able to quote the $280,000 figure because we then met jointly together and Colonial's response at that point was 7 weeks is a non-starter. That came off the table. And their proposal at that time was 6 days, not 6 weeks, 6 days, $500,000. And the mediator figuratively threw up his hands and said, you're too far apart. There's no sense in going any further with this. Let's end it. If you want to come back, you know my point. Now, it was surprising to me because in 35 years as a labor lawyer, I've been through a lot of mediations. This was the shortest one. It couldn't have lasted substantially more than 45 minutes. But in any event, the conclusion that I came to, based on my experience over the last 12 or 13 years with Colonial Downs, is Colonial Downs didn't want to do a deal. This is not the first time that we've had a dust-up or a disagreement. We've had many of them since I got involved in 2000. But in the end, we always sat down, everybody gave a little, and we came up with a deal. This year, completely different story. Now, I have no idea what may or may not be motivating Colonial because it makes no economic sense. We're both suffering now. Makes no sense to me whatsoever. We're perfectly willing to work with them. We're willing to work within the proposal that Commissioner Van Cleef made, 7 weeks, 21 days. That's really not much different than 7 weeks, 28 days. That's where we're prepared to go. Now, I know that Colonial's response in part to our position has been to try and organize or prompt the organization of a rival horseman school. Again, this is no surprise to me. 35 years as a labor lawyer, every time management gets upset over union demands, they try and set up their own in-house union. Colonial's trying to do the same. I think fine, if they want to hold an election, let the horsemen vote to see whether they want the HVPA, who's been here 17 years, standing up for them, or the Colonial Caballeros, or whatever you want to call them. But you know, it's too bad that's where we are. But I think that's it.
There's certainly a lot of misinformation about the negotiations between the HVPA and Colonial Downs. First piece of misinformation is that Colonial and the HVPA were close to a deal for 7 weeks of appraisal. This is simply not true. Colonial Downs first proposed 7 weeks as a compromise. As part of that proposal, Colonial Downs asked the HVPA to share $300,000 in additional costs. The HVPA claims they offered $150,000. Those dollars were illusionary. Let's look at that offer. They offered to agree that Colonial Downs would not have to spend $50,000 for CapEx in the back strip in 2014. The reality is, Colonial Downs spends that money every year as part of normal operations. Virtually year in and year out since the construction of the track, Colonial Downs has spent at least $50,000 for capital purposes in the back strip. Therefore, the elimination of that requirement has no value to us. The other $100,000 related to a potential new mini OTV. As with any new venture, it is speculative as to how it will turn out. You can just look at the history of the mini OTVs we've opened. Many of them, several of them, have failed, really. So at any rate, we were required to sign a 3-year lease for the new OTV. The HPPA offered to help for 1 year. Our ability to collect $100,000 of cash to help pay for the meet required the OTV to be a success. Otherwise, the cash would not be there. When we asked the HVPA to guarantee the $100,000 in the event the new OTV did not generate it, the HVPA is responsible for enforcement. And that is where the conversation ended. So that $150,000 offer was $50,000 that we had to spend anyway, which has no value. And a speculative $100,000 to pay for the real cash costs of $300,000 to pay for the main. Mr. Heddle attended all the meetings and participated in all the phone calls. So rather than put him on the spot, I suggest you ask him privately what transpired. Who was flexible and who wasn't? Who brought ideas to the table and who didn't? And while we're speaking of misinformation, there's one other item I feel compelled to address. One of the advantages of longevity at something is that you're very familiar with the history. One of the disadvantages is that you sometimes forget that everyone else is not familiar with you. The HBPA has made much in these discussions of what they call discounts in the OTVs. The reality is this. We recognize that there is an opportunity in smaller markets to grow handle for the horses and earnings for the track. But we could not do it if we had to pay the statutory purse rate. So we went to the horsemen and said that we would put up the money to build the OTVs. They took less than the statutory minimum purse contribution. They agreed. We invested approximately $15 million to build OTVs in Bent Marks at Scott County and off Street. The horsemen collected purse funds that they would not otherwise have. The statute required that the form of the deal be that we set aside the full 5%. They write us a check back for our share. That's what the HBPA refers to as a rebate. Which, by the way, they're a little delinquent on. That's a matter of another day or another forum. But let's be clear on one thing. This was a revenue-sharing group, a business deal. While an
maybe an example of flexibility is not an example of generosity and charity on the part of horsemen. So where do we find ourselves now? I believe the HPBA's boycott across the state, the localities, the track, and the purse account well over $1 million. So as far as well as people's jobs in the OTBs. Now they're working to expand their boycott to easy horse money, which is a breach of our existing revenue sharing agreement with them, which will cost everyone even more money. The Colonial Downs' vision has always been to aspire to greatness. We want to make Virginia a national player in the racing industry. We've talked about this numerous times. We want to focus on big event days and bring in the best quality racing. We want to grow handle through account wagering and many OTBs where possible. I don't think any of this is news to anyone. I think a more pertinent question is, what is the HPPA's vision for racing in Virginia? They've been given several opportunities to present this, and it frankly always evaded the question. I hope that at some point this morning we get an answer to that question, because I think the commission deserves that. I think it's also important to understand who the HPPA is and something about the horses that they bring them meet. The first thing to know is that the vast majority of the members are not from Virginia. In fact, the state with the largest number of members is Maryland. Now, we understand it's important that people from other states come on the race to Colonial Downs, but think about this for a minute. What are the priorities for horsemen from other states vis-a-vis Virginia? Is their goal to build Virginia racing? Or to simply make it fit their needs. If their need is a place to race horses and $5,000 claiming races, then the desire to improve racing in Virginia or to aspire to greatness is probably lost on them. What do the Maryland horsemen want for Virginia? Even if the casino at National Harbor is left to generate a lot more cash from Maryland horsemen, it might be worth knowing whether they intend to expand Maryland race days through the summer, considering they comprise the largest group of Virginia HPPA members. We've talked a lot about the quality of racing. And by combining the HPPA membership list with the Encompass database, we come up with some interesting information. If you look at the HPPA member trainers with Virginia addresses, you'll find they made 353 starts in 2022. Of those, 146, or 41%, were in $5,000 claiming races. Another 60, or 17%, were in $7,500 claiming races. These are the lowest end races we offer. In these races, on average, they finished 5.6. Even our average field size is 8.8, and in general, they finished in the bottom third of the field. If you look at the stakes races, they made 20 starts. The highlight, of course, was Stephanie Nixon's horse winning the punchline. However, including that win, the average finish was 6.4. Some other interesting things to note were the Virginia trainers raced on 5 3-year-olds. The oldest horse to race was 12. One horse ran 5 times in 5 weeks. A number of others ran 4 times, including a 10-year-old and 2 9-year-olds. While the HPPA has not articulated a vision, one can deduce that they want to expand the opportunities for these horses to run. This seems to be their sole goal, at least the only one articulated. A couple more starts for these horses that run these low races. This is where our visions diverge. We cannot build a meet around horses that are having trouble competing in $5,000 claiming races and expect to be successful. Why is our out-of-state handle that? It's because our product is not very good. So where do we go from here? It's clear that Colonial Downs and the HPPA have significantly different visions for racing in Virginia. And I do not believe the two can be reconciled. Our vision is greatness. We want to elevate Virginia racing to national prominence. That can only be done by raising the purses so that we attract major industry players. That does not mean that there will not be opportunities for Virginia horses and horsemen. However, it does mean that the focus will be on high-end racing with some low-end racing, rather than the current focus on low-end racing with a little bit of high-end racing. I think it would only be natural to ask at this point, why not just patch it up for a year and take the time to reconcile the competing issues? As much as I would like to say yes to that, I cannot in good conscience. The HPPA has made it clear what will happen if they do not get what they want. Horse racing in Virginia is $1 million per self in the county as a result. The HPPA has ignored the BRC and tried to muscle the track to get away without success. So now they feel like they've been unfairly treated. cannot help but find it extremely ironic that the HBPA and a number of its members are here today, presumably to ask the VRC to take some kind of action against Colonial Downs, when the HBPA has boycotted the VRC's race order and clearly believes the VRC has no jurisdiction over it. One other question I hope someone will ask the HBPA today is exactly what authority they believe the VRC has over them. Clearly, they believe the VRC has no authority to determine race dates. So what was the awarding of race dates by the VRC? Nearly a meaningless bureaucratic exercise. We've all heard many times that the goal is to promote, sustain, and grow Virginia racing. What does it mean to promote Virginia racing? Is that just another free t-shirt day? Or is that building a recognizable national brand to sustainability? Which brings us to sustain. Given that it takes money to be in this industry, that almost forces it to be a financial concept. There are only two financially sustainable models for racing. One is the high-end boutique meet, and the other is alternative gaming. We know alternative gaming is not available, so that leaves the boutique meet. Finally, there is growth. Nothing can grow on a long-term basis without a stable base. I think several years ago, the concept of artificially growing days for its own sake was recognized as a mistake. Without a solid base, no permanent growth is possible. Finally, while we are all familiar with the promote, sustain, and grow, I refer you to the second clause of the VRC mission statement that states that this is to be done by prescribing regulations and conditions that command and promote excellence in racing. This is quite a bit different from having your goal being getting one more start for a horse that's having trouble finding places to run. Our vision is excellence in racing, and it dovetails exactly with the intent of the statute and the mission of the VRC. We are looking for a partner to raise the quality of racing in Virginia and to aspire to greatness. We believe those horsemen are out there, and we invite them to join us in the Virginia racing to where it deserves to be on the national.
One point. You didn't answer the question that PG made pre-point. That is, are you willing to consider or discuss this issue of 7 weeks, 21 days? I said we were. You didn't answer the question. What's your answer?
We're always willing to talk.